Please do and show your face. Don't be shy.
Hi, I'm trying to ask a question. About your slide number 16, when you define the outgoing waves,
Yes, I will try.
so you define your outgoing waves according to the sign of the group velocity?
Yes, in fact, it is to doing by a limiting absorption principle, as I explained.
Okay. So in one case, you got the plus solution, and in the other case, the minus solution. So it means that in one case, you have a kind of phase which is opposite to the group velocity, the angular phase opposite to the angular.
Exactly, yes.
So you got some kind of negative index.
Of a negative group velocity wave, yes, of a back propagating wave. Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Boris. Any more questions? So this could be a mathematical question or a physical question. No, I think Anne-Sophie would be particularly pleased if some physicist asks a question. We do have a physicist with us.
It was not clear at all.
I can ask a second question. Okay, this question about the fact that when you make your energy balance,
Yes.
so you claim that you lose some energy. So it means that your physical system, so the initial system without absorption gives a different result from your physical system with a limiting principle, limiting absorption principle.
I will not say that because what happens is that some of the energy is trapped by the corner and cannot escape. So, in some sense, it is here, but it what is unusual when I say that some energy is from an observer located outside. He thinks that some energy is lost, but the energy is the model. It is at the corner, but since the wave is trapped by the corner, it cannot not go back outside, I would say. But then, if we consider that the material should be slightly dissipative, I think that this highly oscillating wave will dissipate some energy at the corner, indeed, but more than usually.
So it means that your system, after limiting absorption principle, does not provide the same result than the system directly when you consider the system directly without absorption. There are two different systems.
I cannot consider the problem directly. I don't know what it means because it is not well posed, in fact. So, what I can consider is a problem with a small dissipation, which makes everybody agree. But without dissipation, there is not a system before and after. At the beginning, we write the equation. We do not expect a problem, but there is a problem. And so we cannot consider any problem which is a limit of what we obtain with small dissipation and which is conservative.
Okay. Thank you.
I have a question then.
Thank you.
Hello? Hello?
Yes,
Yes.
I hear you.
So if I understood you think essentially that you found the limit case that you would, the limit of vanishing dissipation.
Exactly.
If
yes.
You will. Okay. So physically, you know, if you added a little bit, if I just a tiny little bit of a dissipation, this is, you know, there would be very little difference between this solution and very small.
Exactly. Numbers. Exactly. So it is, okay. It is absolutely. And also numerically, even with a small dissipation, it is probably, it is useful and probably necessary also to use this complex scaling, for example, because even with a very small dissipation, the solution is regular, but not, it requires a very, very fine mesh. If you want to avoid a fine mesh, even with dissipation, you can use the methods that I have presented. But of course, it is still a point of view of mathematician because it is for a perfect corner. Now, of course, the corner in general is not perfect. There is small some dissipation. So now there is a trade-off between all these effects. And what we expect that is that in some cases, the dissipation and the perfection of the corner are such that we could observe something like what we describe here. But surely it is not evident to observe that. For example, if the dissipation is very small, but the corner is a rounded corner, a slightly rounded corner, then the wave which will go back, the black hole wave which will be reflected by the corner.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on all these parameters, and it is a challenge to try to observe that in an experiment. It was what we wanted to do in our ANR project, which was rejected so many times. Unfortunately.
Welcome to the club. We got ours rejected for the fifth time, I think, this year. Yeah, about that. So Courvoisier asked if, well, your corner, you know, should be very, very sharp. I mean,
yes.
The roundness, of course, is something that would kill the effect. So would you say that lambda over 100 would be enough, you know, to observe perhaps this effect? Did you make some numerical experiments to see, you know, what would be the kind of roundness that would still preserve the black hole effect?
My point of view is that to observe the black hole effect with a rounded corner, you need some dissipation.
Yeah, but if you have no dissipation, there's no possibility.
No, then the black hole wave.
The rounding
yeah. of the corner is like truncating the strip and producing a reflection. And okay. it has been explained really in details in a paper of Lucas Chesnel and Sergei Nazarov and Xavier Kless.
Okay, and I've got
which can be also interesting, but yeah. It is a okay.
I've got a naive question. What happens if you have both epsilon and mu, which are negative?
So in the case that I have presented, it doesn't change anything. It would be interesting to have some pictures, but at least mathematically, everything is similar.
Uh-huh.
Because really the black hole wave is due to the presence of a sign changing coefficient in the derivation and not in the other term.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, you will have some wave propagating inside the scatterer. But I would like to do some numerical experiments. But for me, I expect globally similar results.
But then, like you said, the object itself, it's no longer opaque.
Exactly.
Inside, you have wave propagation.
Exactly. Okay. So right. Maybe it is not so easy to see the plasmonic wave, but probably it is possible. I think that we did some numerical experiments, but finally here We focus on the case of metal, which seems to be more relevant.
And as far as I remember, you you worked on waveguide theory before, so you know when you have an oblique incidence. So did you consider this case when you have, so now it's a waveguide and you have the Maxwell equation, but you have, you know, some propagation constant.
Yes.
With this kind of configuration.
Ah, okay. You mean a 2D half.
Is it, yes, the exponential I beta Z, you know, Fourier along Z.
So, for Maxwell equations, or for for Maxwell equations.
Yeah, that's for Maxwell, yes, that's for Maxwell, yeah.
So we are working on, finally, we worked on directly on the 3D problem, but it is a, we did not really completely finish the work, and I am not so clear about what we can do. Of course, for the problem you for a problem with the propagation in the direction perpendicular to the pitcher, for the Maxwell problem, we have a coupling between a 2D problem. We can, it depends on the polarization, but for we can have a coupling between a 2D vector problem and a 1D scalar problem for the longitudinal component. And in some cases, only the scalar problem for the longitudinal component makes appear the difficulty, so that we could expect to use the same ideas. But there is a coupling with a vector problem, which makes it not so clear for me.
Because that would be very nice, because your black hole waves would also propagate along the fiber axis.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. That's something which would be really cute, I guess. And also, it was just a very small remark, and you almost answered it. You know, when you consider your closed domain and you put some Dirichlet boundary condition.
Yes.
In fact, according to electromagnetism, it would be better to put Neumann because you have a parallel.
Exactly. It is what...
Because it would be then a metallic boundary. But here,
Absolutely. For this one, it could be... Yeah. It should be a Neumann boundary condition, but...
Otherwise, what you can say is that you treat the case with negative permeability. This is what you did.
Okay. But what we observe is that there is nothing on the outer boundary. So in fact, it is we would obtain exactly the same results, but I completely agree.
But
it would be more relevant to have a Neumann condition.
Yeah, but what you have solved, in fact, I mean, for you, it's just you have solved the problem with negative mu.
In the quasi-static case, it's just considered it's equivalent to consider a negative mu. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay.
Yeah. So no, it's very intriguing, all this, because you say that there are connections also with the work of Nazarov on some cusp or this kind of logarithmic-like. So can you comment a little bit more on this, because it looks, quite far away, this subject.
So, yes. Yes. So, for example, if you have, it has been observed, I think, in Le Mans, in the laboratory of acoustics in Le Mans, when you take an elastic plate with a thickness which is exponentially decaying to zero, you have a Lamb mode, which is going slowlier. So you have such an effect. And what is nice is that in order to absorb this black hole wave and to avoid this problem of perfect or not perfect cusp, they put some material to absorb the wave, which is something like what I do with my complex scaling in some sense. So another idea for electromagnetism, in order to avoid this problem of design of a corner, would be to put an appropriate absorbing material at the corner.
Now I see how it relates to this kind. So you have lump waves on the plate and they pinch the plate to avoid the boundary reflection. Ah, yes, that's really cute.
Exactly.
Okay.
Also in water waves, when you have, for example, a cylinder which is touching the free surface of the water waves, for a linear wave. So I think that the model is absolutely not relevant, but... But however, for mathematics, again, you observe such very strong singularities and this continuous spectrum.
Very, very, very nice. Do we have any more questions? Please come forward because it's really a fascinating subject. You know, you should use this unique opportunity to ask questions to Anne-Sophie too.
If it is not clear, I was really happy
it was
to,
very clear,
to explain something now. No, but sometimes, sorry. Thank you.
Hello, Anne-Sophie, can you say something about your experimental plan and what's the challenge in the experiment?
So it's not my experimental plan, but my collaborators from Institut Fresnel use microwaves. And so Boris and Sébastien can explain better than me, but the idea is not to be at the scale of, for example, of plasmonic waves, but to consider microwaves and to use periodic structure with corner in order to observe what happens. Isn't it, Boris? Can you maybe... Is Boris still here?
Boris? Yeah, he's still there. Boris, can you come?
Yes, I'm coming. the idea could be to consider microwaves at millimeter wavelength or centimeter wavelengths. And to design a composite structure displaying negative effective permittivity, and then to make some measurement of the field of the scattered field by such structure, and the idea is that at the scale of microwaves we can expect to have a geometry with a corner very thin or very very low rounded, let's say. This is the idea that we would like to test experimentally.
So if I'm not mistaken, Boris, usually they work around 10 gigahertz, so the wavelength is about 3 centimeters, the wavelength.
Exactly.
And so in your opinion, what would be the size of your, I mean, what are you going to use, small resonators or just metallic fibers to get negative permittivity or negative mu? You have two possibilities, negative permittivity or negative mu, no?
Yes.
We have the two possibilities, but I don't know. Okay, this is really, really... related to the fabrication possibilities. We have to discuss it with the experimental with our colleagues, specific experiments.
Maybe Brian could comment on that as well.
Can you extend the experiments to the dielectric? For example, you can have some manufacturing method to design some structures with around 100 nanometers.
So I am not the good person to answer the question, but
I think Brian Stout would be, because he's an expert on mist theory. So maybe Brian, can you envisage such an experiment with high contrast dielectric?
The question is, could a high contrast dielectric make an essentially negative epsilon material? And it's mostly been tried with metal, with metal up until now, but I think high index dielectric there is possibilities for it. Yes, to create negative.
But Brian, there is one thing that would be really useful is that Anne-Sophie said you need some dissipation to help with the roundness, and you would have more, I guess, with the dielectric than with the microwave, no? And maybe it would be helpful to actually work with dielectrics for this purpose.
Dielectrics is definitely worth looking into here, because they're going to naturally have that small dissipation you need in order to get the black hole effect. So, you know, whereas metals any sort of metal structures would tend to, even if it's not impossible in microwaves, in the microwave regime for metals, because they also have a little absorption. But yeah, nature is actually working with you here. Even if you have a high index dielectric, you're always going to have a little bit of absorption. So,
I guess that from what I understand, I mean, it looks really possible that very soon Anne-Sophie will see her dream come true, that some experiment will happen in Institut Fresnel.
Fully.
May I ask a question? Anne-Sophie, could you imagine some structure or some small structure that could mimic corner PML? So not only to put some absorption, but also playing with some geometry without reflection, or so could you imagine something like this to mimic a corner PML to solve this problem also experimentally?
Yes, yes. It's difficult. Even for standard PML, the idea in general to mimic the complex scaling by true material is to introduce a layered material. But layered near the corner is not a very good practical solution. That's a problem.
Okay, thank
but
you.
Also, is it so difficult to imagine to have a plasmonic particles, which are some cubes, for example? It is impossible to build some cubes. I don't know.
Well, the whole thing is a problem of scale for me. I mean, the problem is the microwave. It would be lovely if we had a material in the microwave. They just had a plasmonic type response. So you have to go to light wavelengths to get a plasmonic type response in the permittivity, but then your structures are too small. You want to build the structure, then you have to work in microwave regime.
And okay.
We have high control, but then you don't have any materials which are naturally plasmonic. And so your idea would be to have a material that acts as a plasmonic, gives a plasmonic response in the microwave domain, but I don't know of one. And so that's the whole thing, is then you want to build a metamaterial type structure that's going to have an effective negative permittivity. And all of that is much smaller, still structured at a much smaller scale than the point. The idea is that you would have this effective negative permittivity, and then you would use that material to have sort of a point effect. And so that makes the construction of your experimental, it makes the experimental more difficult, because you have to find something that simulates a plasmonic response.
Okay.
That's my opinion on it.
It would be lovely to have a final question from someone in the audience. So please come forward with your question.
Well, while somebody's thinking about this, I just wanted to ask a quiz question Ross McFedrin and they were looking at, we're looking at periodic materials with sharp corners. And
exactly.
A lot of what you told me about reminded me of that. But they were looking for permittivity models, and this ended up generating cuts in the complex plane.
Exactly. The cuts in the complex plane are exactly the same as the continuous spectrum, the critical interval. And in fact, when I was in Marseille a long time ago, I heard McFedran talking about the interval minus the cut interval minus 3 minus 1/3, and so I was very surprised. And it was related to the homogenization of medium with small square, and yes. It is exactly the similar effect that appears, and also that appears in the computation of the. Quasi-mode of periodic gratings that have been computed in Fresnel, and where also we observe some accumulation of eigenvalues corresponding to some continuous spectrum also due to the corner.
Yes.
But you're right that this is related to the continuous spectrum is really the same as a cut in complex analysis, and when I introduce the complex scaling, I am just moving a cut to explore a continuation of the analytic function.
Okay, that's a nice way of looking at it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you to you, Brian.
I think we have also Vincent Pagneux with us. Vincent, can you come forward and ask a question?
Good news.
No, totally. I just arrived. I was in the train just before. So that's the reason why I'm just arriving so late. Sorry about that. So I don't know if asking question without listening to the
So I can answer the questions that Vincent is not
maybe
asking.
It's better.
Because we were discussing about this subject with Vincent before, and one project was to find a configuration where all the energy can be leaked in the corner. So with Vincent and Lucas Chenel, I presented this work in Imperial College in January. Yes.
Yeah,
we are able to find some cases where we can completely transmit the wave in a waveguide from one side of a perturbation to the other side. And so the idea would be to replace one side of the waveguide by a corner in some sense. So there is a wave which comes, for example, in the waveguide, and which could be completely transmitted in the corner so that nothing is reflected back in the waveguide. So it was one of our dreams with Vincent, but we realize now that it is not so easy, but maybe it is also a project that we can have.
Yes, yes. Thanks for the answer to this question.
Actually, it gives me a great opportunity to also announce that Vincent will give a webinar at the end of November, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, yes, I guess.
Yes, I think you agreed too. Perhaps even on the subject related to what you've done with Anne-Sophie.
Yes, one work that we have done with Anne-Sophie and Lucas Chenel once again, and it will be about reflectionless mode, the new kind of spectrum alternative to the complex resonance spectrum.
Excellent, excellent. So I think now that, well, time has come to, everything has an end, even the best. And so now time has come for me to announce the next webinar, which will be given by Michael Weinstein from Columbia University, and it will be on topological metamaterials. So it will be fairly mathematical, but Michael has promised to give a very pedagogical, pedestrian talk, just like in the spirit of Anne-Sophie, so something which would be also accessible to the physics community. And so with that, I would like to thank again our speaker for this great talk, and I hope to see you next week.
Thank you. And goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.